Simon & Schuster Audio presents Surpassing Certainty, What My Twenties Taught Me by Janet Mock. Read by the author.
Dedication. For the girls struggling, striving, and slaying in the shadows. With such little light you sparkle, I am in awe of your brilliance. Epigraph. And the speaking will get easier and easier, and you will find you have fallen in love with your own vision, which you may never have realized you had. And you will lose some friends and lovers and realize you don't miss them. And new ones will find you and cherish you. And you will still flirt and paint your nails, dress up and party. And at last, you'll know with surpassing certainty that only one thing is more frightening than speaking your truth, and that is not speaking. Audre Lorde. Introduction. My back was exposed in a slinky halter as I made my way through Hot Tropics nightclub, my go-to spot on Thursdays in Waikiki. It was a bit past 1 a.m. and the gyrating bodies on the dance floor obscured my view of someone I once knew. I recognized her face at once, wide, open and flat, like she was pressed against a window, peering in. I used to see that same face in high school, across the cafeteria. We never had a chance to say hello, but we were once part of each other's every day. Oahu was small, linking locals socially by just a few steps. It was suffocating. When our eyes met, I felt the shudder of her knowing glare. She was unmoving. I rushed for a seat in a red leather booth nearby to evade her. This also offered me a reprieve from a roster of underwhelming dance partners. My bare thighs slid together as I slinked onto the seat, in strappy high-heeled sandals that helped me achieve my ideal video vixen aesthetic. Clubs are companions for those alone and awake. They fulfilled my desire to be desired, and satiated my itch for a man's body against mine, close, strong, and steady. I resigned myself to the possibility of spending the night alone, because my girlfriend Cassie, with whom I had arrived, could not peel herself away from a Brazilian guy with ravenous hands. Their bodies had settled into a cozy choreography, her lean thigh lifted to his hip, his hand supporting her as she curved her back in ecstasy. Their appetite for each other seemed to mean there would be no room for me in Cassie's Lexus that night. Good for her, I thought, as I watched the guy pet her jet-black mane. The drunken, jubilant revelers camouflaged me as I tried my best to recall the name of the woman from school. She was alone, tall, olive-skinned and dark-eyed, leaning against the bar with crossed arms. She seemed unsatisfied by her own lack of prospects, which made me feel less alone. In a feminist utopia, we'd dance together, make a gleeful exit, and seek satisfaction with stacks of Denny's buttermilk pancakes. Instead, she seemed to stand in judgment. I had long grown familiar with this particular look, knowing, intense, and direct. She knows me, I warned myself. In my 19 years, I hadn't yet gotten used to the fact that nearly everywhere I went, from this club on Cujillo Avenue to the Ward Center cinemas and the pebbled walkways of my campus, someone knew me or had at least heard about me. Privacy wasn't often granted to a girl like me, who had spent years standing out by merely being. It was the price I paid for living my truth. She knew I knew that all it would take to shatter my fragile normality as another pretty girl in the club was a whisper. The last thing I wanted that night was for her to speak. I didn't want to be clocked, to be discovered and excluded. Too many nights had ended with me upset by harsh truths that stripped me of my right to disclose and self-define on my own terms. The truth is a whip when wielded by a malicious mouth, lashing you into obedience and confinement. A stinging reminder that despite your best efforts, you are still captive to others. I was so preoccupied by her menacing focus on me that I didn't notice the towering man with onyx skin approaching me. His full plum lips curved into a smile and made his black eyes even more narrow, like marbles in the clasped hands of a child. He looked like a model on a Shenzhen runway with carved cheekbones, a square jaw, and feline eyes. His head was bald and glistening under the club's neon lights. He wore his handsomeness confidently, but not cockily, commanding me to focus on him as he stretched his hand out to me. "Can I have this dance?" he asked. His presence left me with no other option but to peel myself from my seat. He led me to the crowded dance floor, where he spun me around and away, only to pull me back in. His hands caressed my waist, then slid to the small of my bare back. He made me feel chosen, the reason I had traded the comfort of my couch for the club. Sure, I wanted to be social, but ultimately, I wanted someone to say, "Yes, you. I want you." During a break between songs, I excused myself to go to the restroom. "Can I get your drink?" he asked. "Ginger ale, please," I said as I turned away with a smile. My reflection betrayed me as I took myself in at the crowded restroom mirror. My edges were sweated out, my skin had surpassed dewy and become drenched. At least my body was snatched, I thought, despite an unceasing terror that I was just a burger away from chubbiness. I was young, and my body was resilient enough not to succumb to my late-night diet, Taco Bell Mexican pizzas, Jack in the Box egg rolls, and Zippy's chili and chicken mixed plates. I patted my face with a toilet seat liner, powdered my forehead, and reapplied a coat of Max Per lip gloss before returning to the dance floor. He was standing with our drinks, right where I had left him. "I just heard the craziest thing," he chuckled. "You won't even believe it." "Try me," I smiled, wrapping my hand around the cool, wet glass of soda. "So this woman at the bar taps me on my shoulder, and I'm thinking maybe I know her," he said. "But I don't recognize her, and I just say, 'What's up?' And she's like, 'I wasn't going to say anything, but I think it's fair that you know.' And I just nod, you know?" I furrowed my brow in response and ripped the maraschino cherry from its stem, crunching its sweetness between my teeth. I knew where this was going. I had feared this the moment I saw her. And she goes, "That girl you're dancing with isn't what she seems." And I just look at her because I don't know what she's talking about. "So she tells me that she went to school with you and you were a dude or some shit," he said, chuckling again. And she smiles this creepy smile, waiting for my reaction. And that's when I knew that she was on some other shit. Can you believe that? It felt like a lash across my back, a strip of fire stinging and burning. I didn't flinch, though. Hesitation would have served as confirmation. Instead, I cackled, doubling over as if I had just heard the most ridiculous thing ever. He joined me in laughter. His disbelief served as a salve. He was assured that she was just a jealous girl, a hater, who wanted to push the pretty girl he was smitten with off her pedestal. "My grandma always said that envy seeks to destroy," he said in a melodic southern drawl that I hadn't recognized earlier. "Okay, so tell me the truth," he continued. "I know you're not supposed to ask a woman this, but how old are you?" He looked about 26, so I told him I was 21, lying because I was not of legal age to drink or to be in the club. I didn't care for alcohol then anyway. It made me feel out of control, uneven, slow-witted. I also didn't want to betray the trust of the doormen who let me in despite the ID I wielded. It was real. It just wasn't of me. I had bought it for $60 from a friend's older cousin, a Samoan girl who was similarly hued and could pass for me with a quick scan. "I'm Brendan, by the way," he said. "Nice to meet you. I'm Janet." We locked eyes as if we were seeing each other for the first time, and he held my attention for a few long seconds before a familiar voice cut us off. "Girl, let's go to Waikiki Beach." It was my friend Cassie. "Oh, sorry." She laughed in a sorry, not sorry way. "I didn't know you were having a moment." I had met Cassie, a hapa beauty from Kaneohe with a taste for luxury, a few years earlier through mutual girlfriends. Initially, I hadn't cared for her, but her unabashed appetite for the pleasures of life was infectious. She quickly became my partner in prowling, the girl I blew off steam with when I wasn't busy trying to get through my freshman year at the University of Hawaii. "I don't know if I want to get all sandy," I protested. "Come on," she pleaded. I looked at Brendan to see how he felt about this. "You want to go, right?" Cassie asked him. He nodded. "I knew I liked you. I'm Cassie, by the way," she said, flipping her hair and placing her hand behind her to signal her guy. "And this is Louise." Everyone made pleasantries as we walked out of Hot Tropics and into the fluorescent-lit parking lot, where the woman who had spoken to Brendan stood at the driver's side.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.